Hello, this is Mr. Reinert, and today we're talking about major milestones in American popular music culture. Today I will learn about the history of American popular music culture so I can understand the origins of modern music trends. I will know I have it when I can tell my friends and family two genres that help create modern popular music. So what we're going to see is there's a transition from certain types of music into what we have today. All of this in the middle, there are so many different steps of kind of a flow of where popular music went throughout the years. Okay. One important word to note today is genre. So this word comes from French. It means like a kind or a style of art. Okay. So it could be any kind of art. Obviously, we're talking about movies today. No, we're not talking about movies. Sorry. We're talking about music today. Usually, you can use it to talk about movies like comedy or action, drama, that kind of thing. But this is music. So, for example, pop or R&B, rap, country, many different types of music. All right, so it starts in the 19th century, which is actually the 1800s, okay, with a lot of ballads and spirituals. Ballads are a story set to song, and they're especially popular with Scottish, Irish, and different English immigrants to the US. And this one, Barbara Allen, is considered one of the most collected English language songs and is from the 1600s or earlier, which is pretty shocking. But this was an incredibly popular song in the 1800s.
Twas in the merry month of May, when green buds all were swelling, sweet William on his deathbed lay for love of Barbary Allen.
Spirituals is a type of music that is in a call response form. So one person says one thing, and then the group says the next phrase, and then it's call with the one singer, and then response with the group, and it goes back and forth. It is typically more of a gospel or religious theme. And when we talk about spirituals here, we're specifically talking about the music that was sung by African American slaves in the American South during the time of slavery. And a lot of times they had to do with trying to get freedom or going through the Underground Railroad into the North or into Canada. Or Swing Low, Sweet Chariot is another one that the chariot speculation is, anyway, that it represents the Underground Railroad that's going to come and take you away to freedom. In the case of Jimmy Crack Corn, which we'll hear in a second, basically it's a story of a slave who was supposed to be watching the flies from the horse of his master. And so the flies got real bad on the horse. Slave didn't do anything about it. And the horse started bucking to get the flies away and threw the master off, and he cracked his corn, which is like his head, right? He's cracked his skull and died. And that the slave didn't care that his master died.
Jimmy crack corn, and I don't care. Jimmy crack corn, and I don't care. Jimmy crack corn, and I don't care. The master's gone away. When I was young, I used to wait on my master and bring him his plate. And pass the bottle when he got dry. And brush away the blue tail fly. Jimmy crack home and I don't care. Jimmy crack home and I don't care. Jimmy crack home and I don't care. The master's gone away.
And remember that they didn't have phones or CDs or any sort of method of sharing music with people back then, except for sheet music. And so music would just be sung, or it would be shared with people, you know, verbally somehow, or it would be written down into sheet music. Maybe you'd hear it being played by somebody actually playing the piano or playing the fiddle or whatever kind of instrument it was. A lot of them would become popular, become like folk songs. But the main way that music became popular was through sheet music. Okay, another thing was piano rolls. So they had player pianos, which would actually play a song based on a roll of paper. Okay, kind of like a music box. We're going to go ahead and watch this video about the history of recorded music, how different formats came throughout the years.
What happens when you take one of the most streamed songs of all time, say Drake's One Dance, and record it onto the oldest format of recorded music, a wax cylinder? Okay, stop. Not great. But fast forward to today, and a lot has changed. We no longer really own music. We just stream it. Streaming is almost entirely responsible for getting the industry back on track. But the question is now, can streaming take it back to its heyday after fundamentally changing the way we consume it? Maybe. But first, let's look at how we got here. So, back to that phonograph. This was the start of it all.
Mary had a little lamb, its feet were white as snow, and everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go.
Thomas Edison's invention meant that for the first time, people could listen to music from the comfort of their homes, and it could also be shared and sold. As the phonograph's popularity grew, a few enterprising Americans came together to form what is now known today as Columbia Records. Over the next five decades, the phonograph took different forms, from this cylinder shape to flat discs, until finally being replaced by In 1948, Columbia Records introduced the long play, allowing for multiple songs on one record. Vinyl remained the dominant recording format for most of the 20th century.
Go, Johnny, go, go! Everybody, let's roll!
The ring of fire.
And as rock and roll, blues, and country kicked off, sales boomed and albums sold out. But by the late 50s, new technology would again rock the industry. When first introduced, the RCA magnetic tape wasn't a game changer, but being able to record music on a smaller device for greater portability inspired a series of innovations. Adoption by car makers ensured a quick rise in the tape's popularity, and by the late 60s, most cars offered 8-track players. For the first time, driving down the interstate and listening to, say, the Beatles was possible, road trips got a whole lot more exciting. But it would be Sony that changed the game with the iconic. Yes. With the Walkman, listeners could take music with them whenever and wherever. Around the same time, MTV launched, giving record labels an opportunity to market their music. For artists, that meant it wasn't just about the song anymore, but the ability to offer a whole artistic package, and that became a big focus for icons like Madonna and Michael Jackson. But with the rise of the digital era came the unraveling of the cassette tape. Thanks to booming CD sales, the music industry partied like it was, 1999. Profits peaked that year, with $14.6 billion in sales in the US alone. There was Nirvana and Tupac, the Spice Girls, Oasis, Backstreet Boys, Britney, Mariah, and Selena. Unfortunately, you can only party like it's 1999 for so long. Software like Napster paved the way for a new era of piracy. CD sales plummeted as more and more people logged on. Free music didn't sit well with the music industry, and they fought long and expensive legal battles, eventually seeing some sites shut down. But the damage had already been done. Sharing music over the internet was here to stay.
I've got an iPod here.
And true, with the introduction of the iPod and MP3 players, the industry did see a boost from digital downloads, but it wasn't enough to make up for the dwindling physical format sales, and artists were forced to tour more to bring in the dough. Meanwhile, streaming was just getting started. Some companies introduced subscription models with limited music libraries, while others, like Pandora, operated as internet radio stations with ads. But the breakthrough came in 2011. Swedish startup Spotify managed to do what the others could not: license a vast library of music. Instead of buying and owning songs and albums, we started listening to ads or paying monthly fees in exchange for access to, essentially, all the music in the world. Over the following years, there was an explosion of services. Artists and labels now count on these services for the bulk of their profits from recorded music, while many argue that artists are not being paid enough. Although streaming is responsible for huge revenue growth in the industry, tech companies aren't yet making money from it, and it's still not clear how they will, as they continue to prioritize growth over profits. Plus, if history is any clue, it won't be long before new technology shakes everything up again.
All right, so music is culture, and culture is wealth and progress. When anthropologists, which an anthropologist is someone who studies culture, different groups have different culture. Sometimes an anthropologist will go into a group and really study that culture. But when anthropologists study culture, they say that culture is a sign of wealth and progress. So if we look back at societies from thousands of years ago, if we don't know a whole lot about them, one thing we can tell is if they only have weapons, or if they only have tools in their camps, then they probably were more focused on getting food. They were probably more focused on staying safe than they were on culture. If a community is safe, if they don't have to really worry about finding food, they're in a good area and everything, then they can spend more time, they can spend their free time producing culture. They can make music, art, in our modern world, of course, movies and plays, books, that kind of thing, all counts as culture. So the more of that you see in a society, then the better off that society is considered. It's a sign of peace, it's a sign of wealth, it's a sign of progress. So it's a really great thing that our country has seen so much culture. In fact, our American culture and music, movies, and food too, have spread all around the world, which really says something about of our country. And in fact, from I did a little bit of research and found out that a lot of this is attributed to our freedom of expression here. We have freedom of speech. We have the freedom to express ourselves and to create and share. And it's an open forum for everybody. And so that's why America has dominated the rest of the world, because we tend to be more free than other countries, at least we have historically. And then another point here is that music developed significantly and rapidly, especially throughout the 1960s and into the 1980s. A lot of that was tied to what we just watched with the development progress and market saturation, if you remember that term, of the record player and the record, right? So as recorded music becomes more commonplace, when more people have them, now music can be shared very easily. And as a result, more people become interested in it. Almost for the first time, we have this universal shared music that's never happened before. It's the same power that printed word had, right? The printing press. So the printing press for records, for music, was an amazing technology that a lot of people forget about. Because of that, people were able to develop new genres, and those new genres have continued to develop into the music that we know today. Okay, so here's a list of some of the major songs before the 1930s. And then we're also going to talk a little bit about coal mine working conditions. Okay, so one thing is that they actually used music as a means of protest. And we can look at that with war songs, but also one example that a lot of people have forgotten about is protesting working conditions in coal mines. So here are some examples, if you guys can look at those later. One I want to point out is the Merle Travis song, 16 Tons, with the famous line, "I owe my soul to the company store." And the reason why this is important or significant to me was because this happened to my own family. I know for sure my great-grandpa was in the coal mines in Kentucky. And I interviewed my grandpa about this, and he said that they didn't have any sort of protective equipment whatsoever. And my great grandpa died because he had worked in the coal mine, even though eventually he got out of there and worked in a paper mill. But he got black lung, which is a terrible lung disease that he ended up dying from. But he had also lost two fingers in two separate accidents with mine carts. Okay, basically his finger got crushed and the finger had to be removed. One time, my grandpa remembers the second finger I think he lost. He was walking home from school and he saw his dad walking to the hospital because nobody helped him at work. They didn't give him any sort of bandage or anything. And there was no 911, there was no ambulance. So he didn't have a car. So he walked to the hospital while his finger was still bleeding. He still had his glove on. Okay. They used to have to ride in and out of the mine at night. They didn't bother to make the tunnel big enough. So they had to lay on their backs as they rode the carts into the mine. His best friend was actually killed from a mine accident where the mine collapsed and crushed him. They lived in these poor undeveloped areas where the mines were, and most people had no other choice but to buy from what the company store, like from the song, which was extremely overpriced. And so sometimes because they would buy things from there, they would end up only bringing home like $1 for an entire month of work. Okay. They also had to live in company housing. And they didn't have any running water or bathrooms. Okay, I think they did have electricity because my grandpa said that the big entertainment was listening to the Grand Ole Opry on the radio, which was back in the 40s, I think, 50s. And then they couldn't afford a car. They couldn't afford much of anything. And a lot of people ended up eventually leaving the coal mines to find other work because it was such terrible conditions. But it's such an important job, right? The coal was used back then to heat homes, right? And also, of course, business, industry, factories, all that ran on coal to make electricity. So these people were being taken advantage of in order to help develop the country and power factories and stuff like that. And then after the 30s, because this coal mine thing really went on for a very, very long time. It's not like it's not really the best job nowadays anyway, but here are some examples of other songs we can look at later. And then some more. This is political songs related to the Vietnam War. You could listen to some of these. Same kind of thing. They're using music and art to protest something in the government. But the thing to realize is that mostly only popular songs make the list. And it's something when we say this is that music that was specifically written to be popular in mainstream culture. So unfortunately, a lot of times like R&B, soul, hip hop, country, Latin, other genres don't always make the cut as much as they probably should, just because everyone has their niche kind of genre that they listen to. So it doesn't make it into the overall popular songs. But they were also have extreme followings as well. We can't cover everything. So what iconic songs are there in your favorite genre? How about your parents, friends, and family's favorite genres? Okay, and so there are some other lists here you can take a look at. But that's your homework, is we're going to have a discussion board. Please include in there what your family thought were important songs that should be included, and also what songs you think should be included in very influential, or like a playlist of very influential songs. All right, so we're going to go ahead and watch this history video and listen to some more of your favorites.
Where did American music begin? Well, obviously it began with Native Americans, who were the original inhabitants of America. And then in the 1500s and beyond, when Europeans started coming over and invading, they brought with them their own musical styles that then blended, as well as the African American slaves who were brought over. Basically, America is a gigantic melting pot for a whole bunch of different musical styles and different cultural varieties of music. There are a couple of genres that have really strongly influenced the development of American pop music especially, and that would be African American music and Appalachian folk music, and we're going to talk about each of those a little bit. African American slaves brought with them spirituals, which is a genre of music that is kind of what it sounds like, Christian music that is based on really passionate vocals and in a call and response style, which basically just means imitation. They've been popular in America since the 1700s, where they spread across the South and eventually became popular with white people in the 1800s. One particular style, aside from spirituals, that African Americans popularized in America is a genre called the cakewalk, which is something that was really popular, especially in minstrel shows. And the cakewalk eventually led us to ragtime. And then we have Appalachian folk music, which is hillbilly music, a blend of American styles, black and white, and Irish and Scottish styles. It's from Appalachian folk music that you get honky-tonk and bluegrass, basically the roots of country music. As far as Native American music goes, powwows have been consistently popular, but Native American music has tended to just stick to its own track. It hasn't been as influenced as other genres in like America's gigantic melting pot. We are going to talk about the very broad genre of pop music, which has its origins in the 1700s with William Billings. He kind of headed the whole traveling singer thing that's popular even today. Then we had in the 1800s, ballads and patriotic songs becoming common, along with spirituals and cakewalks, which we've already discussed. In the early 20th century, we had Tin Pan Alley, which was a sheet music publishing house in New York City. This house distributed popular music to people far and wide, running parallel to pop music. Jazz and blues started flourishing in Memphis, Chicago, and New Orleans. Blues and jazz are the real roots of American pop music in the sense that they brought us the first stars in the same way that we think of pop stars nowadays. And this was in the advent of recorded music. For example, recorded music brought to popularity the Hawaiian steel guitar, which is popular in country music even today. So the progression worked by starting with blues, and then jazz took over in popularity in the 1930s, mainly in the form of big band music at that time. And this, in the 1930s, you had swing music in full swing, you had Appalachian honky-tonk going on, and then bluegrass and country were all kind of percolating. And that brings us to rock and roll and the 1940s, which basically started with Boogie Woogie, an offshoot of the blues. This music united teenagers in the rise of youth culture in the 1940s, and you saw stars like Frank Sinatra. And then, of course, we had Elvis in the 1950s, who was covering famous boogie-woogie tunes as well as creating originals, him and others in his genre. We did a whole video on the blues, which I mentioned already, so definitely check that out if you want more depth there. In the 1960s, music started to become more political and lyrics started to become more mature and complex. Think of artists such as Bob Dylan to illustrate that. The 1960s were also the era of doo-wop, soul singers, progressive rock, psychedelic rock, which would then later evolve into funk and punk rock and so on. In the 1960s, America also saw the British invasion, which had artists like The Who and The Beatles explode in popularity. These British bands were blues-based, and then they started leaning into more of the psychedelic rock style. And then towards the end of the 1960s, the political leaning that music had started to fade away. Running parallel to all of that in the 1960s was soul music, which was heralded by big-voiced performers such as Aretha Franklin and Diana Ross. James Brown innovated the funk style at this time, which was influenced by psychedelic rock, but it was groovier and easier to dance to. These genres, soul and funk, would ride a big wave of popularity for about a decade before branching off into subgenres. Rock music began to splinter in the 1970s into a bunch of different genres, such as glam rock with guys like David Bowie, heavy metal with guys like Led Zeppelin, and then punk rock with guys like The Clash. In the 1970s, we also had disco music evolve from funk, and the first hip-hop music started to emerge as well. The origin of rapping is actually quite interesting because it combined two different elements. It combined DJing and also the introductions that DJs received. These introductions eventually became more and more elaborate until it was eventually rapping. And a brief mention to Latin music must be made, especially salsa, which is wildly popular in New York City in the 1970s. Latin music really started gaining steam in the United States in the 1950s, and this music was imported from Cuba and Mexico originally. We did see rumba as the first style in the 30s, and then calypso and mambo in the 40s, followed by cha-cha-cha, bolero, and charanga in the 50s, and then boogaloo, which I've never heard of, in the 60s. Latin styles then started mixing with jazz, and that's where we got bossa nova. And that brings us to rock and roll in the 1980s, with music further splitting, glam metal and punk rock continued to be popular, and then that's also where we saw alternative rock and more hardcore genres emerge. Hip-hop also became more mainstream towards the end of the 1980s, with artists such as LL Cool J becoming very popular. Defining albums were It Takes a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back and, of course, Straight Outta Compton. These albums were super controversial because of their violent nature and R-rated lyrics. And that takes us to the 1990s, where we saw grunge have a short day in the sun that pretty much died as soon as Kurt Cobain, Nirvana's frontman, died in the mid-1990s. When grunge faded away, that gave way to more mainstream and radio-friendly alternative rock. Hip-hop was also popular in the early 1990s with giants such as Notorious B.I.G. and Tupac, who were both murdered in the mid-1950s. A lot of musicians dying in the, did I say 1950s? I meant 1990s. Like alternative rock, rap and hip-hop became more mainstream after the mid-1990s. It was also around this time that singer-songwriters became popular again, kind of like in the 70s, such as Alanis Morissette. And then we also had ska-influenced punk bands like No Doubt and Sublime. And that gave us the bubblegum pop groups of the early 2000s, like the Spice Girls, NSYNC, Backstreet Boys, etc. This is where I'm going to stop our story because it's getting a little too close to where we are now. And this is a history video, so we'll leave it there. So that's rock and pop music. Now let's switch gears and start talking about country and folk music. And we'll start this by reapproaching Appalachian folk music, which we kind of mentioned at the beginning of this video. It started to hit the mainstream in the 1940s with groups like the Almanac Singers and the Weavers. And it was also around this time that swing music peaked in popularity with artists like Bob Wills. Country music as we know it today really evolved out of honky-tonk, though, in the 1940s, especially when mixed with the blues, we get the genre rockabilly, which Elvis Presley obviously made quite famous. People like Elvis were also responding for bringing what was considered black music to white audiences. A lot of parents considered this music that their kids were listening to be very scandalous, thinking they would be corrupted by this race music. And then in a different direction from rockabilly was the country pop music that was happening with guys like Hank Williams and then gals like Patsy Cline. Hank Williams and other of his ilk were the ones who really set Nashville as a main country music hub, which it remains to this day. Gospel music also became popular in the 1950s, especially when it was mixed with R&B styles to make it more groovy and danceable. And then in the 1960s, soul music started separating from gospel in that the lyrics became secular as opposed to spiritual. Aretha Franklin was one really notable example who got her start in gospel music in the 1950s. In the 1960s, the Bakersfield sound emerged to rival the Nashville sound, and this was heralded by guys like Merle Haggard. Bluegrass at the time was also influencing rock music like the Grateful Dead. With the Bakersfield sound starting to dictate the course and direction of country music, that's when you had outlaw country emerge with artists such as Willie Nelson. Country rock bands like Lynyrd Skynyrd could also be qualified under the umbrella of outlaw country. Country rock eventually then led to heartland rock bands in the 70s and 80s, such as Bruce Springsteen. So we've talked about rock and pop, we've talked about Latin, blues, jazz, country, folk, all of those styles, but what about classical music? Well, classical music as we know it originates in Western Europe. So naturally, when people started immigrating to the United States from Western Europe, they brought their musical preferences with them. And this was especially pronounced around the early 20th century when globalization started to become a thing. In the 1700s, there were lots of composers who stuck to the European way of doing things, but you also had American composers who went completely in a different direction from any European influence, starting what was called the First New England School. This style of music was largely written by singers, and a lot of their music was written with really interesting harmonies, but totally doable for an amateur to be able to sing and perform. Anthony Philip Heinrich is one of these composers, and he was mainly self-taught in composition. Again, that's another very different thing from European music, is he had a lot of American self-taught musicians. In the mid to late 19th century, we had the second New England School emerge, such named because it was particularly popular in New England. In this school, there was a group of composers who were really driven to write and preserve American indigenous music, such as John Payne. John Payne had a variety of students whose names you'll probably recognize, such as Edward McDowell and Amy Beach. Now, the composers around this time studied music in Europe, but they were firmly American and based all of their teachings and performing practices in America. Classical music evolved even further in the 20th century with George Gershwin, who was really influenced by spirituals, and Leonard Bernstein, who was really influenced by jazz. These composers were known for blending classical music styles with more contemporary modern styles. Hey, Evan. Major composers like Stravinsky and Schoenberg, who weren't American natives, nonetheless had a really large impact on American music because they immigrated to the States and lived there for a large chunk of their careers. These composers in particular were really influential on classical music and brought us modernism in music. By the 1960s, minimalism became the classical music trend with guys like Philip Glass. This music featured lots of dramatic contrasts, as well as heavy use of synthesizers. Then we had the 1970s and 80s and John Cage and postmodern music. You might have heard of the composition 433. It's that famous piece that has absolutely no notes in it. The sheet music is completely blank. It's just silence for 4 minutes and 33 seconds because the audience and environment is the music. Honestly, orchestra in the early 20th century to the later 20th century just evolved into Broadway and movies. In early movies, you'll often hear overtures as the opening and closing credits music. And then, of course, in cartoons, you hear a lot of orchestral music. And all the way up until the 1990s and early 2000s, film scores were a huge deal, as influenced by giants like John Williams, who wrote probably every film score you've ever cared about. That has now since been replaced by electronic music, and you really don't hear orchestral music in films anymore.